If all goes well, we'll be sending astronauts back to the moon in just a couple years. And scientists have a lot to figure out before then, including the answer to a seemingly simple question. What time is it up there? Astronauts and mission control need to be able to coordinate with each other, but it's not as easy as just syncing up their watches before takeoff. The moon's weaker gravity and its motion relative to Earth throw a weird wrench into the works. So as straightforward as that question sounds, it doesn't have an easy answer, but that hasn't stopped the US government from setting a timer for NASA scientists to figure it out. This isn't the first time we'll be sending astronauts to the moon, so it's not the first time people have had to tell time there. When the Apollo 11 astronauts landed on the moon back in 1969, they unofficially kept their watches set to the time it was in Houston, because that's where mission control was. But officially, both they and mission control would refer to Apollo 11's mission clock, which started ticking upwards from zero at the moment of launch and didn't stop ticking until the astronauts got back to Earth. And to this day, if you wander the halls of a NASA building, you'll probably find at least one clock that tells you how long a current mission has been running. But right next to that proverbial stopwatch, you'll also probably see something that looks a lot more like a standard 24-hour clock. It's not telling you the time in some fancy space time zone, though. It's actually keeping track of a time standard, known as Coordinated Universal Time, UTC for short. And a time standard is a kind of benchmark we can use to measure the passage of time and set other clocks. It's kind of like how for hundreds of years people used church bells or other public clocks to set their watches. These acted as a local time standard. But the concept of a global time standard has been around since the late 1880s, and UTC came onto the scene in the 1960s, which, by complete coincidence, is also the decade we started shooting humans into outer space. UTC measures the passing of time using atomic clocks. These are super dependable timekeepers that work by measuring changes inside atoms that happen at extremely precise intervals. They're as close as we can get to knowing exactly how much time has passed between one instant and the next. But every once in a while, we need to make a small adjustment so that this time stays synced with the Earth's rotation, which changes ever so slightly over time due to things like tides and the movement of the core. Once we make all those adjustments, we get the time we call UTC. Then, to figure out what time it is anywhere on Earth, we just take UTC and add or subtract a certain number of hours depending on which time zone we're in. It works well on Earth because no matter where we are, a day lasts the same amount of time, and the timing of day and night are all that shift from one time zone to the next. And so far, we've also managed to make do by using UTC on space missions. The timing of day and night up in orbit don't align with day and night on Earth, but aside from being a little unintuitive, it's worked well enough. But scientists don't see UTC as a long-term solution for telling time on the moon, especially if humans are going to spend significant amounts of time there. Because time on the moon actually passes faster than it does here on Earth. Wow, that sounds really important. Well, you know where else you can learn important stuff? The newspaper, specifically the Good Newspaper. Good 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 is a team made up of journalists, nonprofit experts, activists, and artists, who also happen to be nerdfighters. As you might expect, they're basically good people. And they've been bringing people hopeful stories in the monthly Good Newspaper since 2017. The paper is full of meaningful good news. It's not puppies in a basket. It's stories of people who see genuine problems in the world and are working creatively and beautifully to make a difference. You know, stories that make you feel more hopeful and better equipped to do more good. One edition was all about progress with pride, another focused on plants, and some of them might be on topics that don't even start with the letter P. But the only way to find out is to sign up and get the next edition delivered to your home. So to get a climate-neutral physical newspaper printed on recycled paper using soy-based inks at your door every month, go to goodnewspaper.org/scishow. SciShow viewers get your first Good Newspaper for just $5, and you can cancel anytime. Thanks to Good 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 for supporting this SciShow video. According to Einstein's theory of general relativity, space and time are part of a single four-dimensional cosmic fabric called space-time, and space-time is shaped by the masses sitting in it. You can somewhat picture this by imagining how a bowling ball would curve the surface of a trampoline. But the key is that it's not just three-dimensional space that gets warped. There's that fourth dimension, time, that gets warped too. And the more warped space-time gets, the slower time seems to move. This is called time dilation. Earth is 81 times more massive than the moon, so it curves space-time a whole lot more than the moon does. And that means if you're standing on Earth, time moves slightly slower where you are than it does on the moon. But there's another source of time dilation, and it has to do with the motion of these two bodies. From our perspective here on Earth, Earth is still, and the moon is whizzing around it. That means means another relativistic effect comes into play here. If two objects are moving relative to each other, from the perspective of the stationary object, time on the moving object passes slower. For instance, if a beacon were flashing on the moon, here on Earth, the flashes would appear slower than they would appear to someone on the moon. This time dilation only becomes noticeable for objects moving really fast, which is why we don't deal with this every time a car drives by or a plane takes off. But we can't completely ignore it when we're telling time on the moon. Now, even after accounting for both these forms of time dilation, the difference in time between the Earth and the moon is minuscule. On the surface of the moon, one Earth day passes 58.7 microseconds faster than it does on Earth. But it adds up. After 5 decades, clocks on the Earth and the moon will be off by about 1 second. But when it comes to operations in space, there's no room for error. Equipment and maneuvers have to be extremely precise. It wasn't a big deal for the Apollo astronauts, who just spent a few days on the moon, max. But if humans are going to spend any extended time on the moon, and that is NASA's plan, we're going to need a solid time standard up there. So the White House has directed NASA to solve this problem before 2027. NASA hasn't yet figured out exactly how they're going to do it, but one idea is just to take some atomic clocks to the moon. These clocks could measure time up there the same way they do on Earth, giving us a lunar time standard called LTC, or Coordinated Lunar Time. The idea is for LTC to be traceable to UTC, just like all our time zones on Earth, but reliable enough to hold steady if people on the moon lose contact with Earth. Now, just because NASA develops a time standard for the moon, that doesn't mean it'll automatically become an international standard like UTC. But it's a start, and once scientists figure this one out, the White House eventually wants to have time standards for other celestial bodies too, like Mars. It might take some time to iron out the wrinkles, but the fact that we need these time zones now is a cool sign that we're entering a new chapter in space travel.